Can see you.
Okay, check, check. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this webinar on management of critically ill COVID patients. My name is Nageshwar Reddy. I work at the AIG hospitals. Over the last few days, we have had several seminars on how to treat patients with COVID and how this disease is evolving. But this seminar is very special in the sense that it's focused specially on critically ill patients who form an important component of these COVID-19 patients. We have a galaxy of speakers who are going to address us on this. Each of them have a huge experience in this area. We have Dr. Dinakar, who is the Director of Division of Internal Medicine at the Sunshine Hospital, and he's going to talk to us on diagnosis and general management. That is followed by Dr. Vishwanath, who is the Chief of Pulmonology at the AIG Hospital, and he'll talk about the important lung manifestations. Dr. Rajiv Menon, consultant cardiologist at the AIG Hospital, will talk on cardiovascular manifestations. And Dr. Srinivas Samvedam, who's the director of critical care, Virinchi Hospital, will talk about invasive and non-invasive ventilatory management. Dr. Mithun, who is the director of hepatology at AIG Hospitals, will talk on liver and GI manifestations. And Dr. Vijay Elandi, director infectious disease, will speak on cytokine release syndrome, which is also an important component of this disease. Dr. Shivaprasad, head of the critical care at the AIG Hospitals, will speak on septic shock. And this will be followed by Dr. Sai Ram, who is head of nephrology at the AIG Hospitals, who will speak on rhabdomyolysis and renal outcomes in these patients. This will be followed by hematological manifestations will be Dr. Ganesh, who heads the hematology division at the Asoja Hospital. And finally, Dr. Bibian Gopal, director of critical care continental hospital, will talk on medications for COVID patients. Coordinating this program along with me is Dr. Naveen, the medical director at the AIG Hospitals. I now request Dr. Dinakar, the director of internal medicine at Sunshine, to start the symposium. Dr. Dinakar.
Yeah, I hope you can all hear me. Yes, good afternoon, friends. Good afternoon, friends, colleagues, seniors, and everybody else who has logged in for this important webinar. At the outset, I would like to thank AIG, in particular, Dr. Nageshwar Reddy and Dr. Naveen for putting it all together. In fact, yesterday I had the occasion to log into the webinar, which was dealt with GI manifestations of COVID. And it's not an exaggeration if I tell you that Dr. Nageshwar Reddy was speaking like more than a qualified virologist. So I thank you for all your in-depth analysis of the whole problem. I have two confessions to make. I have no first-hand experience in treating a critically ill COVID patient. And as we all have had a plethora of information overload, I would say, as far as COVID is concerned, some of my slides are not even a week old, but they already look outdated. So anyway, I will go through a few of the slides. Some of them may be controversial, but we can take this up at a later date. So let me begin by saying the present treatment is still, or the best treatment is still, prevention. And we need to continue the lockdown as we are doing it. Personally, as an individual, we are obligated to maintain physical, or what I would like to call physical distancing, hand hygiene, use of face mask in public places, and definitely in healthcare setup, periodic disinfection of frequent touch surfaces. Because the only thing certain about this pandemic is its uncertainty. And this is a nice model which I picked up in one of the journals, which talked if by chance we continue the lockdown till middle of May, then we may really actually flatten the curve. I'm not proposing this to the management by any chance, to the government, but this is what is one of the matter models. So if Michelangelo was to redraw his famous masterpiece, he will definitely have this alcohol bottle in the hands of this particular painting. We are all aware of how long the coronavirus survives on inanimate surfaces, and therefore the fomite transmission is important. But I would like to turn your attention towards the survival on face masks for almost 7 days. So is this a good time for us to leverage telemedicine for COVID triaging? Yes, perhaps yes it is, because it's convenient and inexpensive, and in-person visits therefore can be curtailed, and so that there is no overcrowding in the healthcare setup. This will also help in the forward triaging of these patients. We also should be cognizant of the fact that novel coronavirus also is excreted, or rather present in simple exhalation, or even when the patient is talking. So whom do we test? Travel and potential contact history, including contact in healthcare setting. We should never forget this, because nosocomial transmission has been to the tune of almost 30%. So patients with upper and lower respiratory tract symptoms, especially those with risk factors, this will be only testing the tip of the iceberg. But at the same time, a country with 130 crore population, it's not possible to test the entire general population like they did in South Korea and Iceland. So what we need to probably target is the community clusters post lockdown, and then look at the hotspots and do the testing. As we all know, that the testing depends basically on antigen detection through either RT-PCR or the cartilage based, the card based nucleic acid testing, Of late, there is also some standardization of the serological tests which can be done through a blood sample where we do IgM, IgG levels predominantly to study population immunity, but time to positive test will be almost as long as 7 days. There are some commercially available kits which will soon be available in large scale. Several Indian companies are coming and making this, but we do not really have studies to show what is the duration of elevated IgG titers in these patients, but this could help us to identify patients who have survived the corona and use their convalescent sera for treating critically ill patients. So the samples which we need to collect are essentially throat and nasal swabs, and other preferred samples once they get into critical care is of course bronchoalveolar lavage and tracheal aspirates and sputum. Important to remember not to induce sputum, because again you are unnecessary aerosolizing and this will lead to spread in the healthcare setup. We also have to know the limitations of a PCR testing, because optimal time of testing is up to within 3 days of onset, symptom onset, and not the moment you suspect these patients. Also remember that the positivity rate is not 100% in this, and BAL achieves the best positivity, whereas sputum and nasal samples are in the range of 63-72%. So please be aware of false negatives, and in strongly suspected cases, do call the patient back for repeat testing in case of strong clinical suspicion. This is how it is transported. Please remember they are biohazardous materials, so a lot of packaging instructions are there. And several centers in India have been outsourced, and also to private labs. So like any or most viral infections, 80% of them will have mild or no symptoms at the bottom of the pyramid. But these are important for community spread. About 14% of them will have moderate to severe symptoms. They are somewhat hypoxic, but can be managed in the triage area or in the wards by just supplemental oxygen. About 5 to 10% of them can become critically ill, requiring intensive care setup. And here the mortality is extremely high, up to the tune of 50%. And what has been found is the presence of comorbidities significantly increases the mortality. And some of them which have been identified in this last study, despite the epidemic being only a few months old, looked at several comorbidities, of which advanced age, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, hypertension, chronic lung disease, cancers, kidney disease, etc., were all important comorbidities. There has been some soft signal about protective effect of BCG, and therefore perhaps children are relatively protected against this severity of the illness. So as you can see from this graph, the older the individuals, this is the number of people requiring hospitalization, this requiring ICU care, and this is the death. The death mortality is significantly higher in older individuals as we go up the chart. Likewise, this looked at hazard ratios of number of comorbidities, and as you can see nicely here, people with more than two comorbidities add up significantly higher morbidities and mortality. Likewise, people with malignancy and two or more comorbidities, as you can see from this hazard ratio graph, had significant mortality. So it is important in the triaging area to identify most of these comorbidities which may contribute to the overall prognosis of the patient. There are no real typical clinical symptoms, as we all know, and fever may actually be absent in about 10% of these patients. So apart from fever, severe fatigue, which may even persist after the patient recovers, dry cough, anorexia, myalgia, etc. are important in varying proportions. But what has been also highlighted is diarrhea as a presenting symptom. And as we know, the ACE2 the receptor is expressed in the ileum and colon, and that probably may be the reason for presentation as diarrhea. Some of them can present with sudden and complete anosmia, as one of the symptoms have been also lately identified. And any of these symptoms can progress over the next 5 to 7 days after the onset. So coming to lab workup, we need routine, apart from routine labs, when you do ECG, please pay attention to the Q3 interval, because this may contribute to overall mortality in terms of cardiovascular worsening, and of course blood gas chest X-ray. Now there is controversy about whether all these patients should be subjected to CT scan upon arrival, especially if they are hypoxic. Now we have to address the issues of infection control each time this patient gets onto the CT scan gantry, and the disinfection issues may come up. But this is something which individual hospitals should drop its protocol depending upon the severity of sickness. Some of the additional tests which are also advocated are ERP, drop IP, because these are all have some prognostic significance, which I will come to in the next slide. And 2D echo, again, whether it should be done at the triaging area itself is important to look at. So we need to think globally but act locally. Maybe we can design our own COVID panel of tests. And as I said, some of these lab parameters have been consistently associated with poor outcomes, namely the lymphopenia, the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio, elevated liver enzyme, the LDH, CR inflammatory markers, elevated D-dimer, proton time, PAPI, CPK, and acute kidney injury. Now, the decision to monitor a patient in the inpatient or outpatient setting should be made on a case-to-case basis. And this will depend on the overall setup on which we are, requirement for supportive care, potential risk factors, and also don't forget whether the ability of the patient to self-isolate himself or herself at home. So all these have to come into the overall decision making and then in turn decide where this patient has to be admitted. So initial management, like any potentially critically ill patient, will basically figure around here. Of course, we have to have infection control practices in place, judicious fluid management in the process of keeping this patient humanly. Don't over-diarize these people and then get into problem of injury. High flow oxygen by nasal cannula is preferred over a mask, because again there's a risk of contamination, etc. And these people, if they are not particularly inconvenienced, can also be put on prone position, because this is known to improve oxygen even in the ER area. Among the use of antipyretics, paracetamol has been preferred over other NSAIDs, because NSAIDs are noted to have certain adverse outcomes. There's no need to give any bolus steroids in the ER level, that we leave it to the intensivist to decide on a case-to-case basis. Again, there's no need for any upfront antibiotics. And glycemic control, of course, goes without saying. In all this, we should not forget the importance of good infection control practice, including the use of personalized protection equipment. And we should also periodically disinfect our cell phones, stethoscopes, BP cups, all these simple common sense points, but needs a lot of commitment and consistency. So coming to actual management, there have been some case reports of using a therapeutic cocktail of vitamin C, thiamine, and zinc. There is a possible role of hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin, and we should be proud that we are exporting this molecule to advanced countries because there is some evidence to suggest that they may probably work if executed early in the course of the illness. There is no need to routinely discontinue ACE inhibitors or ARBs if patients are already on these medications. Likewise, no need to discontinue if they use immunosuppressive agents being used for other chronic diseases. There is no change as far as management for pregnant women is concerned, except minimizing the use for radiology. But we should also be cognizant of the fact that other medical emergencies can present during the incubation period of COVID-19. So, if the patient has any deterioration post-op, please bear that in mind and send for COVID screening, even whenever the situation arises. This is one small study, very small study from Southern Clamps, only 36 patients, but they had the courage to do a study on this. It looked at hydroxychloroquine plus azithromycin. I will not go into the details of the mechanism of action, but that study clearly showed when used combination, it helped better to clear the virus faster. So this is a triage which has been developed in UK, and each of our hospitals can develop the triage based on, you know, the admission baseline blood gas or saturation. Look at them after 30 minutes, what's happening to them. Then you can either put them on high flow oxygen, nasal cannula, or a CPAP or NIV. Evaluate the patient at the end of 2 hours. If the goal saturations are not met, then you shift them to the intensive care unit. So it all depends on the basic setup of the place. So one can draw up the protocols as to how long the patient is actually in the ER area. So the last slide is, most of our healthcare workers are asking this important question: am I part of the cure or am I part of the disease? Keeping coronavirus out when a doctor comes home. And physicians are stranded between our commitment to the community as at the same time to our patients. That's the last slide, and thank you for your attention.
Patients show COVID negative in the beginning, if the patient has significant symptoms and then showing signs of deterioration, it's worthwhile repeating a COVID test again. So with that, I request Dr. Vishwanath to give a small presentation on lung manifestations in COVID patients.
Very good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Vishwanath Gilla, pulmonologist working at AIG Hospitals. As we know that respiratory system is the most common system which is involved in the COVID infection, I would be dealing with the important manifestations in the respiratory system in the next few minutes. Usually a person gets infected with inhalation of the virus or through inoculation of the virus into the eyes, nose or mouth. When these persons get infected, it usually takes 2 days to 14 days for the patients to develop symptoms, which is the incubation period. In 2% of the patients, the symptoms can appear within 21 days. So most of the patients, the median incubation period is 4 days, and most often the patients present with the symptoms of fever and cough, which have been already described. So a brief about the pathophysiology. When a person is infected with the COVID virus has M spikes on its viral envelope, and this M spike binds to the ACE2 receptors, and the virus undergoes replication, and the virus is presented by the antigen presenting cells to the T cells, and which stimulates the cellular immunity and the humoral immunity, which leads to release of the cytokines, leading to cytokine storm, and humoral immunity leading to release of IgM and IgG antibody. This might be important in understanding the therapeutic significance of different drugs like steroids and tocilizumab when you deal about the treatment. And it is important to know that in the beginning, only 50% of the patients have fever. During the clinical course, almost 90% of the patients develop fever, and dry cough and fatigue are the other common manifestations. And when you look at the pulmonary imaging, the chest radiograph can be normal in 40% of the patients, and in rest of the patients it can show unilateral or bilateral patchy infiltrates or a ground glass opacity. Though chest x-ray is considered as standard of care, it is insensitive for the diagnosis in the early part, and it can be totally normal. So a normal chest radiograph should not be used to exclude the diagnosis of COVID. So these are some of the chest radiographic presentations. As you can see in the left side image, you can see that there are diffuse ground glass opacities in both the sides, predominantly placed peripherally. You can see that there is a central sparing. The hilar regions are not involved. And sometimes X-ray may show some indeterminate findings where you cannot make out what is there actually, especially when you do a portable radiograph. And when you feel that the symptoms are disproportionate to the chest X-ray findings, or when you think that alternate diagnosis may be likely, you can consider doing an HRCT scan of the chest. You should not do HRCT scan of the chest routinely, because that leads to a spread of the infection, shifting the patient, transferring the patient out of the ICU into radiology department may lead to risk of transmission of the coronavirus infection. So when you do an HRCT scan in patients when you are suspecting an alternative diagnosis, it might help us find out other diseases a lot of times, like tuberculosis, pleural effusions, and pericardial effusions. In COVID specifically, when you see, the HRCT shows ground glass abnormality, which is present in 80% of the patients. And these ground glass opacities are predominantly peripheral and present in bilateral lower lobes. Sometimes they can be consolidation and reverse halo sign. These are the common findings which are found in the HRCT scan of the chest. Some findings which go against the diagnosis of COVID are pleural effusions, bulky lymphadenopathy, or presence of centrilobular nodules, which generally favor presence of tuberculosis or some kind of atypical infections, and presence of cavitation or unilateral lobar consolidation, which are the unusual findings in COVID. So the British Society for Thoracic Imaging has divided their HRCT findings into a classical, probable, indeterminate, and non-COVID finding. It is important for a clinician to understand which are the classical findings and non-COVID findings, which go against the diagnosis of COVID. Lot of time there is a concern among the physicians, the paramedical personnel, the nursing, whether this could be a case of COVID. So when you do an HRCT scan, it might help us clear to a certain extent, though it cannot totally rule out a COVID infection. So these are some of the CT scans which are showing bilateral ground glass opacities. And this image on the right side shows there's a subtle interlobular septal thickening, which is called as a ground glassing with subtle interlobular septal thickening, is called as a crazy paving pattern. And you can see in the left side image in this slide, there is a reverse halo sign. So which is also again a sign which is described in patients with COVID. We can also see this pattern in other infections like fungal infections or organizing pneumonia. So a HRCT pattern itself cannot be used to diagnose COVID. Along with the appropriate clinical suspicion and a HRCT findings may help us in making a diagnosis of COVID. these are the CT scans which are showing centrilobular nodules, which are the findings which go against the diagnosis of COVID-19. When these patients have a severe pneumonia, these patients develop a dreaded disease, that is the acute respiratory distress syndrome, which can happen in approximately 3% of the patients. Though all of these patients have severe hypoxemia with bilateral chest infiltrates, which fit into the typical Berlin definition, these patients have a different phenotypes and they present with different clinical features actually. This paper from Gattinoni et al, who has done pioneering research in ARDS, has suggested that these patients present differently. Some patients present with a severe hypoxemia and they have a normal respiratory compliance. In ARDS patients, generally the compliance is very low. So some patients can initially present with a normal respiratory compliance, and a subset of patients can present with severe hypoxemia with reduced respiratory system compliance. Some patients, even though when they are hypoxemic, they look normal when they walk into your outpatient. So it's important for you to check the saturation of the patient in addition to the pulse BP, which we routinely check. Some patients obviously present with hypoxemia and dyspnea, then it's easy for you to detect. But for patients who are presenting with normal breathing, you should be watchful about these patients. So depending upon this compliance, this group has divided the ARDS into L type or H type. L type is the low elastance type. Basically, these patients present with this L type of ARDS in the early phase of the ARDS. Elastance is inversely proportional to the compliance. So these patients have a high compliance. As they have a high compliance, even you apply a PEEP or do a prone positioning in these patients, they have a less recruitability and they do not respond to high PEEP. In fact, when you apply high PEEP in this subset of L type of patient, it may lead to hemodynamic compromise. And predominantly the reason for hypoxemia in this patient is a low ventilation perfusion ratio. Ideally, when you have an hypoxemia, the hypoxemia should lead to pulmonary vasoconstrictions. But in these patients, there is loss of pulmonary vasoconstrictions leading to an imbalance in the ventilation perfusion ratio and leading to hypoxemia. How should you identify these patients when you look at these patients clinically? These patients have a bilateral ground glass opacities in the CT scan. When you look at the patients with H type of ARDS, generally these patients are in the late phase of clinical presentations. They have a high elastance or a low compliance. They have more recruitability and they have good response to PEEP and proning. And the reason for hypoxemia in this patient is in shunt physiology. Because of the alveolar flooding, which happens because of extensive consolidation or atelectasis, the blood goes unoxygenated to the lungs, leading to a shunt physiology and severe hypoxemia. So patients can progress from L type L into H type, and this depends upon various factors, the host response, the severity of the infection, and different factors can lead this patient into H type. So this clinical spectrum has been already covered by Dr. Dinakar. Most often these patients are mild, have mild disease, and a percentage of patients have a severe disease, that is they present with dyspnea or hypoxemia. And patients who present with respiratory failure, shock, or multi-organ dysfunction syndrome are classified into a critical disease. And case fatality has been different in different countries, and it also depends upon the demographic factors of that particular country. And in this particular article, which was published in Lancet, it was shown that when a patient was admitted into ICU, 60% of them had a very critical prognosis, and the mortality was 80% when the patients went on to develop mechanical ventilation. And these are the risk factors for severe COVID infection: presence of underlying advanced age or comorbid conditions, and you look at the clinical signs and look at the labs which have been covered by Dr. Dinakar. So to conclude my talk, actually, these patients have an incubation period ranging from 2 days to 14 days, and the coronavirus attaches to the ACE receptor on the human cells by its human spike. Fever and cough are the most common symptoms. Chest X-ray can be normal in some patients, or else it can show ground glass opacities or infiltrates. When you do a CT scan in these patients, ground glass opacity is the most common findings. The findings which go against COVID infection are presence of effusions, presence of nodules, cavitation, or a unilateral lobar consolidation. And you should be aware of the phenotypes of the ARDS, L and H type. And also you should be aware of the different factors which can lead to an increased fatality in this subset of patients with ARDS. Thank you all for a patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. Vishnath. I think the key factor is that hypoxia should be kept in mind, and we should continuously monitor the oxygen saturations. Probably high flow nasal cannula oxygenation and prone ventilation are the initial ways of treating. Subsequently, of course, you require treatment for the full blown ARDS.
Yes,
thank you very much. Now I request Dr. Rajiv Menon, who is the consultant cardiologist at AIG Hospitals, to give a small presentation on cardiovascular manifestations of COVID disease.
Robin, presentation. Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. I'll be talking with some of the critical care cardiovascular manifestations of COVID and the management aspects associated with this. As we know, most of the people, when we talk about COVID, we think about respiratory issues, but more and more now we realize that for the first time, the patient might actually present with a cardiovascular manifestation. Just to give you an example, this was a 54-year-old male in New Delhi. This is on April 1st. If you see the ECG, you'll be able to realize that the patient is having ST elevations in the inferior leads and a complete heart block. So this is a classical inferior wall MI with reciprocal changes, which was taken up for primary angioplasty. And after the primary angioplasty, the patient apparently appeared okay, but within 48 hours, this is the X-ray of the patient. Bilateral haziness, anybody would interpret it as pulmonary edema or as a ARDS. And what happens next? The patient expires and finally the COVID comes positive. So this is what we are looking at today once the community spread of COVID starts. Just to give you an idea of the overall significance of cardiovascular disorders, when we look at comorbidities, which was spoken of by the previous speakers, you realize that nearly 40% of the COVID patients who were sick had underlying cardiovascular disorders compared to even hypertension or diabetes. So that's a huge number of people who are having underlying cardiovascular disorders. And what is the cardiovascular injury in COVID? The case fatality rate in cardiovascular disorders, if you compare with hypertension or diabetes, is almost 10.5%. Just imagine around 7 to 6% with diabetes or hypertension, whereas more than 10% with patient with underlying cardiovascular disorders. They have very high troponin levels, high incidence of LV dysfunction, and most of them end up in ICCU. Now the NHC data, which has come up recently from China, has indicated that 11.8% of the patients with COVID develop new cardiovascular disorder. That means they might develop a new LV dysfunction, shock or death. So a patient with no prior CVD for the first time after COVID, in 12% of the patients might actually present with a cardiovascular disorder. Why does this heart injury occur? There are various mechanisms which have been proposed, including hypoxia, hemodynamic instability, shock itself reducing the blood supply to the heart, a cytokine storm, and AC interaction, which is coming up now, but we still surely don't know how this COVID through ACA, which is present in the heart, can produce a direct injury to the heart. Now, there is a spectrum of presentations which can occur in a patient who has COVID as far as the cardiovascular disorders is concerned. The most common of them is ST elevations. Now, please note that I have mentioned ST elevation and I have not mentioned acute MI. We'll just come to that in a minute, why ST elevation as a presentation is important. It could be a cardiogenic shock, it could be decompensated heart failure, it could be arrhythmias, and most recently again, the issue about venous thromboembolism is coming up. We don't know in the coming days how this will turn out to be a major player in the pathogenesis of the cardiovascular manifestations of COVID. Now, what I have done is I've just put around three clinical scenarios, the common scenarios which you might come across as physicians, and how would you handle in your setup. So the first clinical scenario is ST elevation. Now, it could be because of a type 1 MI, the common ST MI, which occurs because of plaque rupture. Now, this is uncommon in a patient with COVID. A type 2 is the most common, which is the supply-demand mismatch. It could be just myopericarditis, which is producing ST elevation, or it could be a stress cardiomyopathy. Any of these could present in a COVID situation. So how do we approach? It's important to start off with a proper evaluation of the patient, any history of fever, exposure to COVID, or whether the patient is already diagnosed as a COVID positive. The examination, again, looking for any crepitations, any pleural rub, any fever in that patient can help you in suspecting that this could be COVID and not a proper cardiovascular disorder. The lab investigations, of course, will help you, as was told by the previous speakers. Something which is coming up is the elevated ferritin levels, which probably might help you or at least make you suspect that this could be COVID and not the just routine run-of-the-mill ST elevation. ECG, we all know a patient with MI typically presents with a vascular territory ST elevations and a convex ST elevations, while a patient with myopericarditis might present more with a diffuse ST elevation which are concave upwards. Now, something interesting which is coming up is what is called as a COVID ECG pattern. If you see this ECG, you can see global ST depressions and ST global ST elevations and ST depression in AVR, which is something interesting which is coming up, though we need more data to decide whether if we see this ECG, we immediately suspect COVID without any pre-existing fever or cough. If you are lucky to have an echo with you, definitely you can see here that you have a myopericarditis on your left where there is a pericardial effusion. And to the right, you have a stress cardiomyopathy, the basal segments contracting very well, whereas the other segments are, the apical segments have the ballooning which is there. So that is quite classical for stress cardiomyopathy. How do you manage? Now, it depends upon whether you're in the community spread stage or you're still in the initial stage of COVID. If there is no community spread, you still continue with your normal algorithm. But now there is a community spread, then we have to treat all patients as a suspect COVID unless proven otherwise. So how does the treatment or management of these patients change? If the patient is suspected or confirmed, as was again mentioned by others, the treatment has to be in isolation room with proper PPE precautions. Thrombolysis, if the patient is within 12 hours, the window period is less than 12 hours. Shift to PCI center or think about primary angioplasty only if the patient is in shock, heart failure, or has electrical instability. You are doing it as part of a rescue angioplasty strategy, or the window period is more than 12 hours but less than 24 hours. So compared to a normal protocol where you would try to push every patient who has an acute STEMI to a primary capable center, in these situations, it might be preferable to go back to our good old thrombolysis and think of primary PCI as and when indicated. Now, all other drugs, we need to follow the protocol. One word of caution is there are beautiful tables which are available on the internet for each cardiac drug. What are the interactions with the anti-COVID medications which we are giving? So spend few minutes in trying to see if they have any interaction and then only go about it. This has been very elegantly put as an algorithm by the European Heart Journal. I won't go into the details. What we discussed just now has been put in an algorithmic form, which the physicians can find it extremely convenient to follow. What about same ST elevation with myopericarditis, stress cardiomyopathy? Naturally, if the patient has tamponade, you tap pericardial fluid. Hemodynamic support when there is instability, like IABP or ECMO. Steroids, as of now, we have no role in myocarditis. Immunoglobulin, again, no role. Antivirals are still under study, and convalescent plasma, again, is under study. As far as hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin is concerned, we'll just come to that in a bit. Now, as on today, we still don't have definitive evidence that there is a virus affecting the myocardium, or there has been no biopsy which has been done from which they have actually isolated the virus. This is as far as the ST elevation presentation is concerned. Let's look at other common presentation which can occur, where a COVID on treatment develops torsades. So you are now called because the patient has developed a torsades. This is an example of the ECG. On the top shows a polymorphic VT, the torsades, and the ECG below shows the prolonged QT interval which can precipitate this type of a torsades. Now, if you just look at arrhythmias in COVID, in the WHOBI registry, there were about 7% of the people who presented with palpitations. In Wuhan, it was about 17%. About 44% of the patients in intensive care actually had some form of palpitations. What were there? The tachycardias, again, still sinus tachycardia continues to be common. We can have AFib or atrial flutter. What we are most worried about is VT, which takes the form of torsades. Now, luckily, bradyarrhythmias are slightly rare, and the incidence has been found to be quite less in patients who have developed COVID. How do we treat it? How do we look at it? First, you look at what is actually producing these arrhythmias. Is it myocarditis or ischemia? Is it hypoxia shock? Is it electrolyte disturbance? Is it QT prolonging drugs? or very rarely, just the fever of COVID might be precipitating these arrhythmias in patients with underlying channelopathies, like, for example, Brugada. So you need to look into that. How do you manage? Again, it's quite simple. If it's unstable, you just follow the ACLS protocol, no difference from the ACLS protocol. If the patient is stable, if it's a single episode, give IVA magnesium immediately and then discontinue all the QT prolonging drugs. Correct other electrolyte abnormalities. If the patient is having repeated episodes, follow the same thing, but there is a role for overdrive pacing and even isoproterenol infusion to prevent recurrent episodes. Another common scenario which the patient might come to you is where, or the doctors might ask you, is where the ECG is showing QT prolongation, patient is already diagnosed as COVID and is on hydroxychloroquine, and they ask you what to do. This is a very good risk assessment which has been given by American College of Cardiology, where the total score comes to 21 to assess the risk of torsades. Low risk is generally less than or equal to 6, moderate is around 7 to 10, and high risk is more than 11. How do we go ahead managing these patients? First, correct all reversible factors. Just don't say stop hydroxychloroquine because QT has got prolonged. First, correct reversible factors. Look at what are the relative contraindications, like congenital long QT or the baseline QT more than 500. If the QRS is more than 120, then you take a QT of more than 520 or 530 as a relative contraindication. You monitor. A simple way is repeat the ECG after 2 to 3 hours. If there is an increase of more than 60 milliseconds or the similar baseline increase of around 500 milliseconds, then you first stop azithromycin. Among the two drugs, stop azithromycin and try to reduce the hydroxychloroquine dosage. After that, still the patient continues to have a prolonged QTC, then consider stopping hydroxychloroquine. So those are some of the clinical scenarios which we commonly find, and that's how we manage patients with COVID. Thank you very much.
These have been showing that they are using vasodilators extensively for these patients, or of course not in hypertension.
So the problem presently is we don't have any definitive study to say whether we should give something or we should not give something. Everything is anecdotal and people are trying to experiment with whatever therapy is in hand, including anticoagulation, vasodilators. Some empirical therapies are being given with our understanding of other cardiogenic shock. But as on today, except for the mechanical circulatory support, we don't have any definitive evidence for any drug to be superior over other.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Rajiv. Now we'll move on to Dr. Srinivas Samvedam, who is the director of critical care, Virenchi Hospitals. He will talk on invasive and non-invasive ventilatory management. Dr. Srinivas.
So good afternoon, everyone, and special good afternoon to Dr. Somaraju, sir, who is watching. Good to see you again, sir. Now, the next 10 minutes or so, I'm going to take you through the concepts of non-invasive and invasive ventilatory support, specifically for the SARS-CoV-2 disease causing COVID-19. Now, before we look at going into machines and mechanisms, few basic issues about the management of COVID we need to understand, remember, reiterate, and always follow in our practice. The fact to remember here is that there is no emergency during a pandemic. You need to take time, you need to take precautions, you need to prepare yourself, whether you are securing the airway, whether you are setting the ventilator, whether you are clearing the airways, you are doing a tracheostomy, you are proning the patient. You need to remember that your life and the life of your team is of paramount importance. While the person whom you are treating is struggling, you may not be actually doing justice by rushing and compromising on things. That's the basic point we need to remember. And when you are handling the airways of these patients, the most important thing to remember is that anything that is related to airway, you should be aware of aerosol generating procedure. And you, in order to achieve these three goals of being careful, being protective of your team, and taking care not to generate aerosols, you need to be calm while approaching ventilatory support in patients with COVID. So just a quick look at what are the aerosol generating procedures. The intubation and extubation. Remember, extubation may look good. You probably would have saved a sick patient, but you follow the same procedure and precautions as you do for intubation, because the aerosolization is exactly the same when you are extubating somebody as you are intubating somebody. Manual ventilation should be reduced to minimum. Open suctioning is a complete no. Continuous closed suction systems are mandatory in patients who are being ventilated with COVID. No CPR as far as possible, or extremely measured, extremely protected CPR. Bronchoscopy again needs to be very carefully done, and tracheostomies. That brings us to the concept of ventilatory support for patients with COVID infection. What are the options now? Whether it is a alveolar pathology, whether it is a vascular pathology, whether it's a cardiovascular pathology, nobody knows. This disease has beaten everybody. So nobody is exactly able to tell us what is the exact pathophysiology of the disease. But the constant, persistent, presenting symptom or manifestation is hypoxemia. And we are all in a rush to correct this hypoxemia. The options we have for correcting this hypoxemia are a simple face mask, maybe a Venturi mask, your high concentration mask, which will give you close to 95% oxygen, FiO2. The alternative is a high flow nasal cannula, which can generate some degree of positive end expiratory pressure as well. You could give non-invasive ventilation with an ICU machine. You could try to give an NIV if you are overburdened, you're running short of machines. You probably will have to give NIV with a standalone machine which is used in the wards. If all this fails, you have invasive ventilation. And if invasive ventilation is not winning the match for you, you go for extracorporeal support. So these are the options we have of supporting a hypoxemic patient with COVID. Let's look at the high flow nasal cannula. If you look at the initial reports that came in from China and then subsequently from Italy, there seemed to be a widespread concern about viral transmission, especially with the lateral spread of air with a high flow nasal cannula. But if you look at the various guidelines which have come subsequently from the European Society, from the American Society, the WHO, they all seem to be suggesting that high frequency nasal oxygen or high flow nasal oxygen is a recommended therapy for hypoxemia associated with COVID, as long as the staff are wearing optimal airborne personal protective equipment. Now, this is a very useful tool. If you look at the emerging evidence of a lot of intensivists and specialists in the field saying that mechanical ventilation may be the wrong solution to the hypoxia of COVID, high flow nasal cannula, which gives a more focus on oxygenation with a milder PEEP, may be a better option in this context, or something we need to think about. The risk of airborne transmission to the staff is low if well-fitted newer systems are used, when optimal protection equipment and other infection control precautions are being used. If in an ideal setting, the high flow nasal oxygen should be administered in a negative pressure room, but if that is not possible, which is most likely to happen in this country, we should ensure that the cannula is a tight fit so that the lateral spread is reduced. This is what the ANZICS guideline on HFNO is suggesting. And the WHO seems to be saying that recent publications suggest that the newer high flow nasal cannula systems and the NIV systems with a tight and good interface do not create widespread dispersion of exhaled air, and therefore should be associated with a low risk of airborne transmission. That's the WHO's position on the use of high flow nasal cannula. So in a country where we are short of ventilators in the best of circumstances, in this era when if the surge happens, we will be short by a big margin. So optimizing the use of ventilators can be achieved with the use of high flow nasal cannula. So the high flow nasal cannula supplies gas at a rate of 40 to 60 liters per minute, whereas a normal cough achieves a flow rate of about 400 liters per minute. Therefore, it's doubtful that a patient on high flow nasal cannula is more contagious or more contaminating than a patient on a standard nasal cannula who's coughing in an open ICU. So we should not let go of a useful therapeutic modality just because there is a fear that it could spread the aerosols. The next option we have is non-invasive ventilation. Now, the concept here is unless you are treating a COPD patient who's unfortunately got stricken with the COVID infection, traditional BiPAP with pressure support may not be effective in these patients. The most effective modality of non-invasive support seems to be the continuous positive airway pressure, those whose compliance is good. Now, the fact we need to remember when we are looking at these patients is that we look at the Italian data, you look at the Spanish data, you look at the data that's coming from the United Kingdom and the original data from China. There is a very good phase of this disease when the lung compliance is absolutely good. These are the happy hypoxemics. These patients come into your ICU with a SAT of 75-80%. They are breathing absolutely normal. They are hemodynamically stable. They are not struggling to breathe. The work of breathing is not too bad. So these are the patients in whom, while you try to optimize their oxygenation, the CPAP may be your best friend with an improved mask seal to improve your safety. If you look at the entire spectrum of data that's come out of Italy, majority of these patients were administered non-invasive ventilation with a helmet mask. The helmet mask might theoretically have an advantage over the oronasal mask, but we still have to find out the bigger evidence for this, but that seems to be a good option. But when you put the NIV, make sure you've got viral filters on both the the mask fitted proximal to the connecting ports. That's one important step you need to take in difference to what you would have done in a non-COVID environment. And when you connect the non-invasive machine, there are machines which use a single limb circuit. There are machines which use a two limb circuit. So if you are using a two limb circuit, which is quite often the case with an ICU ventilator, a BiPAP mask can be connected to a traditional mechanical ventilator with an inspiratory and an expiratory circuit, and filters are placed on both the circuits. And then that will generate a completely closed system, assuming no mask leak. This is a 100% closed system, so your chances of contaminating the environment are not very high. It involves a full-featured mechanical ventilation, so you're sacrificing an ICU machine for giving non-invasive ventilation at the expense of somebody who might need invasive ventilation. That's the only flip side of this story. On the other hand, if you have a portable BiPAP machine or a standalone NIV machine, you typically have a one-limb circuit where the BiPAP machine is connected to the non-invasive machine, and the expiratory port should also have a viral filter connected to it so that the environment and the people working around are not exposed to the expiratory flow from the BiPAP machine. It's not enough to put the filter only on the inspiratory limb, and that's what it means. So you need to put, while we put it on the inspiratory limb of the single limb circuit, you need to put the filter also on the expiratory side of the single limb non-invasive ventilation circuit. That's something we need to be meticulously paying attention to. Invasive ventilation should be your last resort for these patients, because the mortality is unacceptably high at the current point of time. So try awake-prone ventilation prior to intubation. So if you have a good fitting nasal high-flow nasal cannula, or you have a good interface of NIV, try to put the patients prone while they are awake with non-invasive ventilation. This can be tried with high-frequency nasal cannula in those patients who are not in multi-organ failure, with the expectation that the patient has a fairly reversible lung injury and you might avoid intubation. And patients are not hypercapnic or significantly dyspneic, mentally normal, they're able to communicate, and you don't anticipate a difficult airway. So this is a checklist which you have to tick before you think of proning them awake with one of the adjuncts which we have already discussed. Now, when it comes to indications for intubation, you need to have a very robust system. Remember that happy hypoxia is very common. So that means these patients are starting 76 or 80, but they are not working hard. The work of breathing is not high initially. So their lung compliance will be absolutely normal. So alveolar pathology, ARDS, although pathophysiologically they look like ARDS, your ventilatory strategy may not be the right thing if you just follow the ARDS-NET guidelines and set the ventilator as per the ARDS protocol. You may be doing harm to the lungs in these patients. There is a high risk of transmission during intubation, so all airborne precautions need to be taken. The best is to have a pressurized airway respirator, which is not easily available in most big ICUs, even in this country. Video laryngoscopy is the norm. The senior most hand should intubate. The time to intubation should be quick. Muscle relaxation is the must. And you need to have an aerosol preventing box placed on the patient before, while you are attempting it. Several models are circulating and several adaptations are available where you have a working port at the head end or on the sides through which you use your video laryngoscope and you intubate the patient. There is no big science about ventilating these patients. The conventional ARDS strategy, again, I would reiterate, we should be cautious while using the conventional ARDS-NET protocol for ventilating the early stages of COVID infection. You should focus on optimizing the oxygenation, but not with the expense of using excessive PEEP. Focus on minimizing your disconnection. So when you're intubating, before you connect the machine, clamp the endotracheal tube and then get the circuit connected and then release the clamp and use proper protection all the time. Prone these patients very carefully. In the NHS, in most of the units in the NHS, what they are having is called as a proning and a supining team. So every day morning, this proning team actually rounds on the COVID ICU and the treating team gives them a list of patients who have to be prone and a list of patients who have to be supine. So this team of four or five hands in the ICU may not be medical staff. They may be volunteers who have been trained in this technique of proning, go around and flip patients prone, or those who are prone will flip supine. We can't reach that level of staffing in this country yet, but prone them very carefully, because if you lose the airway during the process of proning, it's a disaster in the ICU. So you're contaminating the entire environment. But disappointing note here is that outcomes of mechanical ventilation so far have been bad. There have been a few success stories, but when you look at MERS-CoV ventilation, when you look at SARS ventilation, when you look at the H1N1 pandemic ventilation, the outcomes on those mechanical ventilations have been reasonably good. But the outcomes in this mechanical ventilation are not very good. The duration of ventilation is much longer. The average length of stay of somebody who gets ventilated for COVID is more than 2 weeks, whereas in the SARS MERS-CoV, it was between 7 and 10 days. The reason being, the pathophysiology is more of a vascular phenomenon to begin with, and then subsequently deteriorating into an alveolar pathology. So we need to be looking at what stage of disease we are initiating this ventilatory support. If you don't do it, if you don't succeed with invasive ventilation, the choice is ECMO. Again, ECMO has been very, very disappointing results across the world. So what is different in mechanically ventilating other ARDS patients versus the hypoxemic COVID patients? In these patients, when you intubate a normal ARDS, you expect the lung compliance to be bad. So you focus on plateau pressures, you focus on inverse ratio ventilation and all that stuff. But here the compliance is good to start with. And in the conventional ARDS, you expect a reasonable response to PEEP in more than 50% of the patients. That kind of a response to PEEP is missing in this ARDS. And right heart strain and RV dysfunction seem to be happening very early in the course of this particular disease rather than the conventional ARDS, where you expect RV dysfunction to happen during the second week of illness. But here, RV dysfunction, RV strain is happening in the first week of the illness, which probably is going to tell you that you are dealing with a microvascular thrombosis in the pulmonary circulation, which can explain quite a few of this. But again, I would say it is neither a respiratory disease nor a cardiovascular disease. COVID is a multi-system disease. We haven't yet looked at what's happening to the liver. There have been reports of neurological manifestations. We haven't looked at what's happening to the kidney. Acute kidney injury is not unheard of in these patients. So it's a multi-system disease. Extubation failures are reportedly higher in these patients, possibly because the demand for ventilators is much higher. So patients are getting, we are just quickening, or we are just jumping the gun and extubating. For some reason, vocal airway edema seems to be very common in these patients, which we noticed even during the H1N1 first outbreak in 2009 as well. So that is another reason. And an emergency intubation, you know, the adrenaline kick that happens during an emergency intubation, infection control usually is bypassed. So that's a danger of extubation failure. And as I said, RV dysfunction is occurring very early in these patients. So we need to develop our own systems of overcoming this RV dysfunction. And mortality, unfortunately, if you get ventilated, mortality is several times higher than your usual mortality. So this is a projected algorithm, which is no big rocket science. This is all what we know. So you typically start with a low flow nasal cannula and then go to a high flow or a CPAP. Then you prone the patient with a high flow nasal cannula or the CPAP. If this fails, you go to invasive ventilation. As long as the patient is here, you are looking at reasonable outcomes. But once you are here, you're probably going to lose the match. Unfortunate truth is that we need to accept that. And invasive, again, you need to target. If it is an alveolar pathology and your compliance is gone, then you are justified in targeting the 4 to 6 mils per kilogram ideal body weight of ARTSnet recommendation and use the conventional lung protective ventilator strategy. You could also use airway pressure release ventilation and prone ventilation. So if you are not succeeding here, it's veno-venous ECMO. I'm not sure whether it's only veno-venous ECMO. When you accept that it's a venous thromboembolism and RV dysfunction is happening very early, I'm actually thinking whether veno-arterial first up should be an option, but again, evidence is not very strong. So thank you very much for the opportunity. I thank Dr. Naveen and his team at AIG for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Srinivas. I think it was very, very good presentation. We got a lot of new points. We were thinking that early intubation was the way of treating, but now we understand happy hypoxia and then how we can delay the ventilation. And also about CPAP, we were all thinking that NIV is contraindicated because of the aerosol protection. Probably with a good protective PPEs and other measures, we should be able to use CPAP. Thank you very much. Now we'll move on to Dr. Mithun, who is the director of hepatology at AIG Hospitals. He will give a presentation on liver and GI manifestations in COVID patients. Dr. Mithun.
Good afternoon, everyone. So GI and liver manifestation is COVID is possibly the most minimum of what we get. I'm not getting my slides yet.
Thank you, Srinivas. I think it was very, very good presentation. We got a lot of new points. We were thinking that early intubation was the way of treating, but now we understand happy hypoxia and how we can delay the intubation. Also, about CPAP, we were all thinking that IV is contraindicated. Probably with the protective PPEs and the measures, we should be able to use. Thank you very much. Now, we'll move on to Dr. Mithun, the director of pathology.
Yeah, so, should we start?
Yes.
Yeah. So my presentation today is on the liver and the GI manifestations of COVID. So I'm divided my talk into two parts. The first part will be on the GI manifestations in COVID-19, and the second would be on the liver manifestations. So basically where it all starts with the virus binding with the ACE2 receptor and then getting entry into the cells and then starting to cause all the damage. Since it's a virus which gets attached to the receptors, so it can affect any part of the body which has the receptors. So if we see the gastrointestinal tract and the liver, so the ACE2 receptors are present in the intestine, bile duct, liver. It is present in very high concentration in the colon. It is also present in the tongue, liver, the pancreas, and so possibly any of these organs can get affected by COVID-19. The first case of GI manifestation in COVID was this 35-year-old young person who presented with cough and fever, and then on the day 2 and day 3 of admission developed nausea, vomiting, followed by diarrhea and abdominal discomfort. This patient, they examined the stool and they found that the stool sample was positive for COVID-19. This was also positive in the nasopharyngeal swab. However, they did not test the patient after day 7 to document whether the amount of virus shedding in the stool continued even after the nasopharyngeal swab was negative. What we know about the GI manifestation of COVID-19 is that the initial cohort of around 1,000 patients published in the NEJM of around 552 hospitals, it reported only that 5% of patients presented with nausea, vomiting, and around 3.8% of the patients presented with diarrhea. This was followed by another study which has a totally contrasting results. It was a study of 99 patients which showed that 48.5% of the patient had digestive symptoms, and when we remove anorexia as a non-specific symptoms, 20% of the patient had specific GI symptoms like diarrhea, vomiting, and abdominal pain. A pediatric cohort of 171 patients also had diarrhea and vomiting as a presenting symptom. And in this pediatric cohort, when they took rectal swab, it was found that viral shedding was noted in 8 out of the 10 patients who had COVID-19 infection. If we see this paper, which was published in Gut, it included 95 patients, 58 patients had GI symptoms. What was surprising was that 11.6% of the patients had symptoms at admission, whereas around 50% of patients developed GI symptoms post-hospitalization. And the most common GI symptoms were again diarrhea, anorexia, and nausea. And in those patients who developed GI symptoms post-hospitalization, it was more in the cohort of patients who received multiple drugs. Some patients received antibiotics, some patients received antiviral therapies. Out of these patients, 65 patients underwent sampling of the stool for COVID-19. 42 patients were with GI symptoms and 23 patients without GI symptoms. What was surprising was that in 23% of patients without gastrointestinal symptom, even in that 39.1% had presence of viral RNA in the stool. 6 patients with GI symptoms underwent endoscopy, and if we see in 2 cases which had severe infection, the COVID-19 RNA was found in the tissues in esophagus, stomach, duodenum, and rectum. Also, in the patients who underwent endoscopy, one patient had esophageal erosions and one patient had some ulcers with some amount of bleeding located in the esophagus, thereby possibly indicating that SARS-CoV infection can also affect the gastrointestinal tract. A lot of concern has been raised by epidemiologists about a fecal-oral transmission. So we should understand that this virus has also been found in saliva for that purpose. And serial monitoring has shown a decrease in the salivary viral load in patients after hospitalization. But what is more important is that extrapulmonary detection of viral RNA does not necessarily mean that we have an infectious virus present. One study has shown that the infectiousness of the viral RNA is very less, but we are still not sure about it. Data is emerging, and whether digestive system could be another way of community transmission is largely something which needs further research, and time will tell us about that. This publication on 42 patients with confirmed COVID infection with stool RNA positive, around 66% patient did not have GI symptoms. What was more important was that the duration of viral shedding from feces continued even after the pharyngeal swabs were negative. So mere testing of the pharyngeal swab and then labeling a patient negative may not hold good, and possibly the mean duration of fecal shedding of the virus is around 6 to 9 days. They tested the urine samples of these patients, but there was no viral shedding in the urine of the patients of COVID-19. Finally, this meta-analysis of 4,000 patients showed that around 17.1% patient had GI symptoms, which was slightly more in patients with severe disease than with non-severe disease, but it is too early to conclude that gastrointestinal symptoms points towards a severe disease. From the GI perspective, in summary, GI symptoms are encountered in COVID-19. The exact mechanism of GI symptoms are not very clear. There is no evidence to correlate it with severity. Viral RNA is found in most GI tissues and also in stool, which continues to be present even after pharyngeal swabs are negative, and we need to explore if fecal-oral route can be an alternative mode of community transmission of this dreaded infection. The second part of my talk will be on COVID-19 and the liver. What I feel is that, going through the literature above, is that majority of these patients of liver disease will have more collateral damage than direct damage. What I mean by collateral damage is that we are not able to give care to our liver patients because of this infection. This was the initial study. We showed that there was mild increase in the transaminitis and the bilirubin levels in patients who had been infected with COVID-19. Further studies have shown that this AST-ALT elevation is found in quite a significant amount of patients of COVID-19. One patient who had very severe liver injury has an ALT levels of around 7,000 plus. Also, the proportion of AST elevation was slightly more than the ALT elevation, suggesting that this AST rise may not be only from the liver, but it could be from other sources, because there is evidence of muscle injury also in patients with COVID-19. What we know is that among this huge number of patients who had COVID infection, only 2 to 11% had liver comorbidities. Unlike we report a lot of patients with diabetes, hypertension, why the number of patients of cirrhosis is low in this cohort or published data, we don't know. Possibly it may not be as big a risk factor as it is thought. The incidence of liver injury ranges from 14 to 53%. The commonest is an AST-ALT elevation, but in patients who have died, the liver injury may be as high as 78%. Because the ACE2 receptors are present in the cholangiocytes, therefore many of the studies have shown increase in GGT levels, which is the diagnostic marker of cholangiocyte injury and can be present in 54% of patients. The possible mechanism of liver injury is that it could be an ACE2 mediated hepatocyte and cholangiocyte injury. It could be a direct viral cytopathic effect on the hepatocyte, just like a viral hepatitis. In fact, one paper has been published where it says that it can present as acute hepatitis. It can be a part of the cytokine storm effect that happens in the course of the disease. And finally, many of the drugs that have been used for treatment of COVID could have some effect on the liver, and it could be drug-induced liver injury. So the approach to a patient with COVID-19 with a raised AST-ALT, the guidelines as of now say we have to check for common causes like hepatitis B and C, ultrasound to be done only if we are thinking of a biliary obstruction or a venous thrombosis. If the liver test continues to improve, we just monitor. If it is worsening, we rule out other causes, like whether it's a part of the myositis or whether it is ischemia or whether it is a drug-induced liver injury. The role of liver biopsy is not yet established, whether we should go ahead in these patients. So in another analysis, what we see is that around 33% of patients have a mild elevation in AST-ALT, whereas 10% will have around 2 times elevation of AST-ALT, and around 2.4% to 1.6% will have around 5 times or more elevation of AST and ALT. The first peak may be due to cytotoxicity. The second peak may be due to inflammation or drug-induced liver injury. The last part of my talk is, how does it affect the patients already diagnosed to have a liver disease? So it is more of a collateral damage. When the big boss fight, there is always a collateral damage. There has been a COVID registry which has been tried by the Europeans, but if you see, the number of enrollment is very, very less. As of now, there has been 21 deaths reported on CLD patients. These guidelines have been released by the European Association of Study of Liver Disease. It says that chronic liver disease patients, include compensated cirrhosis, should postpone their routine hospital visits, do test as an off-site labs, and do telemedicine whenever possible. Patients of viral hepatitis like hepatitis B and C should continue their normal medications. Patients of non-alcoholic fatty liver and NASH should better take care of their comorbidities if they have, like diabetes and hypertension. There is no recommendation for reduction of immunosuppressants in patients with autoimmune liver disease, though there is a stress on pneumococcal and influenza vaccination. And in compensated cirrhosis, we're supposed to make a routine visit to the hospital. We can delay HCC surveillance because the doubling time of HCC is around 6 months, and we can go for the alternative assessments of variceal screening, like seeing the platelet counts, or unless they bleed, we better not do endoscopies in these patients. In decompensated cirrhotic patients, including hepatocellular carcinoma, listing for liver transplantation should be done only with patients with very short poor term prognosis. Many guidelines have said to include patients with MELD score above 30. We should emphasize on vaccination. We should strictly follow the guidelines on SBP and hepatic encephalopathy. And it is now recommended that we include the testing of SARS-CoV-2 in any cirrhotic patients who has an acute decompensation or is presenting with ACLF. What to do about the patients who are already listed for liver transplant? We should acknowledge that both donor and recipients reports may be negative, but it doesn't rule out infection. A concern should be taken about the potential risk of nosocomial COVID-19 in both the recipients and the donor. Living donor liver transplant should be considered only on case-to-case basis. In patients with liver cancer, the treatment should continue. If they have an infection, early admission and monitoring is recommended. In my post-transplant patient, we should continue the monitoring by standard guidelines. We should emphasize on vaccination. There is no recommendation for reduction on immunosuppressants, though the American Association initially suggested that we reduce the steroid levels to 10 milligram of prednisolone, but they have issued another guideline yesterday where they said that this is not correct and they are retracting that. And all patients who are stable should continue to monitor their drugs and do telemedicine consultations. So what happens to our liver transplant program? We should understand that there is a donor screening. The donor comes to the hospital. There is a risk of transmission. We should be aware of our resources, whether we have the ICU ready, we have blood bank, blood shortage, and staff shortage. So at this time, routine or elective liver transplant should possibly be postponed. We should assess the risk-benefit ratio because there is a risk of post-transplant infection, and there is also a risk even in cadaver transplant if the COVID-19 is negative, yet it can transmit. If you see this transplant curve in Spain, they were doing in the center around 118 cases. Till 5th of March, it has dropped down to 1.6 case as on 20th of March. So, on May. So finally, we should understand that most of the drugs that people are trying for COVID-19 are safe in liver patients, but they can increase the levels of the calcineurin inhibitors that we are using for post-transplant patients. So we should keep a watch on these drugs. This is the registry, the only data that has come out from the Spanish registry of 68 patients of post-transplant. We showed that 60% patient had mild disease, 40% had severe disease. Out of this 40% patient, if we see 3% were in ICU, 7% had a bad evolution, and 20 patients still had a good outcome. What is important to note, that patients who are on immunosuppressant, including transplant patient, there is prolonged viral shedding. So it's recommended that a PCR should be done around 5 to 10 days after the end of treatment, or before we say that somebody doesn't have COVID-19 in a post-transplant setting. In summary, liver injury is not significant yet, though higher enzyme elevations are noted in sicker patients. The mechanism of liver injury may be multifactorial. HCC screening and variceal screening to be deferred. Vaccination has been emphasized by all the guidelines. Cirrhotic and pre-transplantation patients should possibly move to telemedicine and admissions should be minimized. SARS-CoV testing should be included in both donors and recipients who are undergoing transplant, with an important fact that we should take a written consent that there is a risk of nosocomial infections, and liver transplant to be considered only in a select group of patients, possibly whose short-term mortality is very high, like a MELD score of above 30. Thank you so much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, sir. Some of the centers, they have been using sofosbuvir for treating COVID. Do you think it is right approach.
So sofosbuvir, what is saying that sofosbuvir possibly is being used for many of these patients of COVID, but the guidelines say something very contradictory. What he says that if you find somebody who is newly detected with hepatitis C infection, it is better you defer the treatment with sofosbuvir, velpatasvir till the COVID infection or the COVID crisis is out. So these are two contradictory statements. It's a controversial area because the liver guideline says even in patients with established need for sofosbuvir, please delay them. Right. But whatever we are using in COVID-19 is possibly experimental at this point of time.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so
much. Thank you very much. Now, Dr. Vijay Aldandi, who is the authority in infectious diseases world over, he would speak to us on cytokine release syndrome. It's not connecting. Sir, can you speak on? Are you able to hear us? Audio issues there, I think. It's a recorded version. I think you sent it. There's an audio connection with Dr. Vijay Aldandi is not proper, so we will just move on to the next speaker and then we'll come back to Dr. Vijay Aldandi after that. Next topic will be by Dr. Shiva, is the head of critical care at AIG Hospitals. He will speak on septic shock, treatment of septic shock in COVID patients. Top.
Yeah, a very good afternoon to one and all. Today I will be dealing a very, very important topic, that is septic shock in COVID. So we all know ICU patients have a very high incidence of septic shock, and this high incidence extrapolates into pretty high mortality. Well, even COVID has septic shock. Okay, but before I start off, let me give you a word of caution to you, because most of the evidence which is available is all anecdotal evidence, and most of the studies which have been published recently are all retrospective studies. And what I have done is extrapolated various other studies and presented them to you. Okay, with that, I would start off. What exactly is the problem statement of septic shock in COVID patients? It's various studies have what you call 1% to around 35%. Like you have Chinese studies saying they themselves do not have any what you call correlation between what exactly is the incidence of septic shock. It's like probably, few studies say it's around 1-35% and all, not one marker. Italian studies have said that it's around probably around 75%. You have the American studies which are telling it's around 65% of patients have admitted to the ICU have septic shock. Then what exactly is sepsis? Sepsis is nothing but, again, defined by your sepsis guideline. That is, it's a dysregulated host response. Dysregulated, or it's an organ, life-threatening organ dysfunction due to a dysregulated host response to infection. So what exactly happens here? It is some sort of bacteria, virus, whatever it causes, some sort of immune stimulation, and that immune stimulation goes haywire, and that causes an organ dysfunction. So what exactly happens in this? There are two mechanisms by which you have septic shock in these patients. One thing is a direct mechanism, that is your virus itself causes some sort of an insult and causes an increase in the systemic inflammatory response. Or sometimes it is a secondary bacterial infection which can cause the initiation of systemic inflammatory response. And based on this systemic inflammatory response, there is a compensatory anti-inflammatory response syndrome which also picks up in the body, and then you have various levels of organ dysfunction. Mind you, this is oversimplification of all the things which are happening in a case of septic shock. So as I said you earlier, see, if there is the primary insult causes a significant what you call systemic inflammatory response, it can cause an early multi-organ dysfunction. If it causes a late, if the CARS is predominant or the compensatory anti-inflammatory response syndrome is high, you can cause a late MODS. So when does this normally occur? Usually in COVID patients, it has been found that it would be presenting around probably seven to 10 days range. And usually how do we diagnose it? It is very simple. Based on your sepsis guidelines, sepsis 3, it has what you call any confirmed infection or what you call any suspected infection having, you require patient who is in hypotension even after adequate volume resuscitation, then you have to, and the patient is requiring vasopressors, then you should consider this as a case of septic shock. So what exactly is the management? The management of septic shock is no different from the septic shock in a routine patient. There are guidelines, what you call basic guidelines, basic tenets of treating a patient with septic shock. That is, you have to identify your source, you have to isolate your source, you have to start appropriate antibiotics, and you have to give adequate fluid resuscitation. So these are the basic tenets. In fact, based on these basic tenets, the surviving sepsis guidelines has come up with newer guidelines just recently, 10 days back on 27th and 28th of March, with what you call the COVID management of critically ill COVID patients. So I'm going to tell you certain experts from this particular guidelines. So the first and foremost thing is, I was telling you this patients would require volume resuscitation, especially anybody who is having a shock would obviously require volume resuscitation. But then how to assess if this patient would require volume resuscitation or not? For this, you have to have what you call your dynamic parameters such as your pulse pressure variation, systolic pressure variation, and your straight leg raising test or passive leg raising test. In fact, these are all beneficial when you compare this with the static parameters, where you can see static parameters such as your CVP or what you call mean arterial pressure, they have a very low sensitivity, but then your dynamic parameters have a very, very high sensitivity. Mind you, this is a study which is from what you call, not from the COVID patient, but in a patient having septic shock. Okay, coming again, continuing with the fluid therapy, we can also monitor the what you call assessment of fluid requirement by your serial serum lactate measurements. Okay, so is it less than 2? Is your fluid resuscitation adequate? And is your serum lactate levels dropped to less than 2 would be considered as your what you call appropriate fluid therapy. And then where you have various studies again from what you call non-COVID septic shock patients, basically this is a meta-analysis which is showing that what you call you have what you call which favors what you call usage of early lactate clearance in the management. Not only this, you have what you call the Andromeda shock trial, which has actually come up saying that you have your capillary refilling timing. Your capillary refilling time can be used in place of your lactate clearance, because thing is, or not all patients, especially in terms of resource limited settings, you will not have what you call settings wherein you can do a repeated lactate levels. So in those patients, you can do what you call your capillary refilling time can be assessed every 30 minutes, and then maybe you can consider, yes, the patient's shock is improving or not. Okay, what should be the acute fluid resuscitation? So usually it is that it should be crystalloids and it should not be colloids. And you have various studies again which have said what you call in septic shock patients, if you are using colloids, you have a very you have a higher mortality compared crystalloids being used. Then, and what should be the fluid, what should be the appropriate crystalloid which should be used? That should be your either it should be a balanced salt solution, a Ringer lactate or a plasmolite, or the newer other balanced salt solutions can be used. Okay, and what should be the vasopressor which should be used in these patients? The first vasopressor after adequate fluid resuscitation has to be norepinephrine, which is similar to the what you call your septic shock patients. And you should target a MAP of around 60 to 65 mmHg. Okay, yes, even after norepinephrine, your BP is not picking up. What you should do is you should add some second what you call vasoactive agent, such as vasopressin can be used. But if the patient is having a cardiac dysfunction, the appropriate choice would be to use a dobutamine in place of your vasopressin. Okay, you are having a still refractory shock in these patients. So what are you going to do? Yes, steroids are one of the things. Stress dose steroids are actually being advocated in patients with septic shock. So how much can we give? Around probably 200 mg over 24 hours, either infusion or what you call divided doses can be given. In fact, there are various other meta-analyses which have suggested that, okay, in septic shock patients, you have a role in favoring usage of low-dose corticosteroids in septic shock. Okay, what are the other treatment modalities which we can use? The other treatment modalities are empirical appropriate antibiotics have to be initiated based on your hospital antibiogram. And then rest of the things like symptomatic supportive therapy, such as what you call if the patient is having an AKI, maybe you need to consider renal replacement therapy. If the patient then the patient has to be supplemented with nutrition, and all other supportive cares have to be given routinely as you treat with a septic shock patient. Okay, then what other things can be done? Yes, these patients, because of the very high cytokine levels, there is actually some other thing which is being considered as an extracorporeal cytokine removal or cytokine adsorption, which is being done, which will be discussed by the next speaker. Okay, what would be the prognosis of patients, septic shock patients with COVID? As it has been previously described by the previous speakers, the mortality is very, very high. And patients coming to the ICU in septic shock, various studies have said that it is approximately around 50%. And then again, various studies have given a various range. Chinese data has given that probably it's around 26% what you call mortality in these patients having septic shock. Whereas Italian data again saying that it is what you call still higher, whereas your American data says that it is around what you call 52%. So it is very, very high mortality in patients who are having septic shock. So with this, I would like to conclude my talk with certain things, certain take home points. It is very, very simple. We should know that the septic shock in these patients is not very common, but it is very common in patients who have got admitted to the ICU. And then we should also know that it is not different from your routine septic shock care. It is all the methodology, all the measures are the same. What you practice in a patient with septic shock, you have to do the same things, except that you have to have an extra PPE for you. And then we should have our basic tenets in our mind, basic tenets of treating septic shock, that is your isolation of the source, then what you call identification of the source, isolation of the source, empirical antibiotics, and adequate fluid resuscitation. So with this, I conclude. Yeah, thank you.
In patients with COVID disease?
So usually we can consider, we usually do a serum procalcitonin, which can be done, or CRP is also being done currently, and even we send regular cultures, maybe higher fever spikes, then rising counts. Usually COVID is suggestive of significant leukopenia, if there is a significant leukocytosis, while usually it is considered as a secondary bacterial infection rather than a primary COVID-related septic shocks.
So antibiotics are started only in those situations?
No, sir. Empirical antibiotics are suggested to be started because we don't know what patients, COVID patients might be having some secondary bacterial infections. In fact, we are also having secondary viral infections. Most of the reports what we are getting currently is having COVID positive and also H1N1 positive as well. So it can be what you call multiple infections. So ideally we have to stick on to our basic tenets. Yes, we have to find out if there is a source, identify the source first, and then we have to treat the COVID.
So when do you start empirical antibiotics?
At initially only.
At the initial stages.
At the time of septic shock, yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank
yes,
you.
Thank you, sir.
We'll quickly move on to Dr. Vijay Eldandi. He's back with our connection, and he will speak on cytokine release syndrome. Dr. Vijay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, please go on, sir.
Yeah. Are you able to hear the voice?
Yes, we are able to hear very well. Please go on. Please go on, sir. The slides are on.
Yeah, the voice is playing or not playing there?
Well, voice is playing, sir. We are able to hear you very well. So please go on.
Okay. Are you able to hear the sound?
Very well, sir. We are hearing very well.
Okay, see, let me. So this slide just shows that the cytokines that are all activated by the microbial pathogens, we can get pro-inflammatory responses or anti-inflammatory responses. Okay. Now, exactly what happens and what balance there is between pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory cytokines is what really determines the outcome in the patients. Okay. If there is exaggerated inflammation, there is a lot of tissue damage, there will be death in the patient. Yes.
Next.
So in there's a lot of thrombosis and activation of the coagulation lytic systems. So vascular injury, eventually hypotension, tissue hypoxemia, and eventually death.
Next slide.
So beautiful paper by Denning. And what they show is that danger associated molecular patterns interact with what is called as neutrophil extracellular traps. These are basically neutrophilic enzymes like myeloperoxidase, other enzymes, as well as DNA. And these participate in the severe inflammation and tissue damage that occurs.
Next.
And this is very important in acute lung injury.
And once again, thank you for your attention.
So a lot of other substances are also released, and probably some of these substances also contribute to inflammation that we see due to cytokines in the body. Very nice paper that shows that early interferon response is very key into containing the viral infection. If this early interferon response is not seen in the initial infection, that leads to an exaggerated inflammatory response and a bad outcome. So the key is the early interferon response should not be blocked. Very beautiful mouse model, a transgenic mouse that expresses human DPP-4 receptors. And what they show is that there is a lot of complement mediated damage. Complements are deposited, particularly the terminal attack complex is deposited in the tissue. And that is a lot of damage that occurs because of this terminal attack complex. Now, so this is a good evidence that complements are very important in coronavirus infections and lung injury. Now, you can see in the same model that if you block C5, which is a common pathway for complement mediated damage, this damage will be attenuated at the tissue level. And also a lot of the pro-inflammatory cytokines are also ready. Now, also what we see is if you block complement, the amount of virus that is seen in the tissue is also drastically reduced. Human data, what we see is we see a marked lymphopenia, particularly in very sick patients, the absolute lymphocyte count drops to 800 or below. This is very important. Now, we also see that increase in natural killer cells and also T helper cells. Now, very interestingly, we see a very high ferritin level in the very sickest patients, and the ferritin actually goes above 800. This is a very interesting paper by Pedersen and Yachi Ho. What they see is that sickest patients, there is a marked increase in IL-6, LDH, CRP, and also ferritin. And there is, at the same time, just like the other patients, a marked lymphopenia, particularly the helper T cells and the CD4 cells. These levels of cytokine storms actually correlate very well with the tissue damage that we see, particularly amongst the lungs. Another paper, this Chen and Associates, they also show a marked increase in pro-inflammatory cytokines, particularly IL-6. It's a very interesting paper from autopsies. And once again, just like the animal models, over here we see in kidney, there is a marked deposition of the terminal attack complex of complement. So clearly, complement seems to be a very important part of the tissue damage that is seen both in the lungs and as well as the kidneys. all of these things, you know, the lymphopenia, the marked increase in ferritin, and the lung damage, the kidney damage, you see, this is all very reminiscent of the immunology of the macrophage activation syndrome. And we see this in other viral infections like CMV, influenza, Crimean Congo hemorrhagic fever, histoplasmosis, and also in the hemophagolymphohistiocytic syndromes. The cytokine storm suggests that we can use to block IL-1 with anakinra, canakinumab. We can block IL-6 with tocilizumab. We can block the JAK system by tofacitinib. And probably we should also think about whether or not blocking complement with eculizumab makes sense for some of these very sick patients with acute lung injury and acute kidney injury. Finally, the therapeutic implications of understanding cytokines is that indiscriminate blockade of cytokines will be counterproductive. An early interferon response and inflammatory cytokines are part of the host response to infection and should not be blocked. It is the delayed interferon response that actually leads to greater replication of the invading pathogen, a lot of inflammatory cytokines and tissue damage. So that is the level at which it would be helpful to intervene with an anti-cytokine regimen. So lack of clearance of the pathogen is responsible for the cytokine storm. So too early a blockade of cytokines will actually predispose to infections. And we have seen that in rheumatologic disorders where we have used anti-TNF or tocilizumab or JAK agents, they get more opportunistic infections. So one has to pick and choose the exact moment where IL-1, IL-6, or anti-complement blockade may be beneficial. And it may be that one agent alone will not work, just blocking at one locus will not work. We may have to use multiple loci. And the key is that we have to select the individuals who respond very, very carefully. So how do you predict a macrophage activation syndrome or a cytokine storm? Now here's where I apply what I am calling the Yaldandi rule. If the absolute lymphocyte count is below 800 or the ferritin is greater than 800 and you are seeing evidence of organ dysfunction, maybe that's the best time to start thinking about blocking cytokines. In the future, we may use more precise genetic markers, and this is where genome-wide association studies will help us figure out which patients will likely require this kind of intervention because they are at very high risk for cytokine storms. So clearly a controlled clinical trial is absolutely imperative.
Most slides are there, sir.
Yeah, so the next slide will come on now. So the next slide put a lot of references.
Okay.
And I've also put this on YouTube. So please feel welcome to go to the YouTube site, my Facebook site, which has Happen for One Health. And the entire presentation is available with all of the slides on both of us.
Okay. So thank you very much, Dr. Vijay Yaldandi, sir. It was a very good presentation, and we like that Yaldandi rule, wherein lymphocytes below 800 and ferritin levels higher and any organ dysfunction evidence will be the right time when we start the medications.
Yeah, I think the key here to understand is that one should not block a priori the early interferon response to a viral infection.
Yeah.
And this is a key thing to understand because a lot of people are recommending chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine as prophylaxis. And one is concerned that the use of these agents blocks the early interferon response. So it may actually be counterproductive. However, once you have the interferon response period passed, that may be the time to actually start thinking about chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, azithromycin, because now the the early response to containing the virus has already been triggered. And what we want to do is avoid the excesses of the inflammatory response due to cytokines.
Thank you very much, Dr. Vijayal Dandi. Now we'll move on to the next topic of rhabdomyolysis and renal outcomes by Dr. Saira. He's the head of the nephrology at AIG Hospitals. Dr. Saira.
There's a whole lot of literature out there. There's a cornucopia of literature out there on the websites of American Society of Nephrology and International Society of Nephrology. I would recommend you to go through the guidelines or the, instead of guidelines, I would recommend you to go through some of the articles that are coming out of, especially New York City, considering the authenticity of the literature coming out from this hospitals. And I've interacted with some of my colleagues back in New York to get a better idea of what's going on there. The data that I'm presenting right now is from Montefiore Hospital in the Bronx, New York, which has seen some of the highest incidences of kidney disease and the COVID cases. 44% of these patients who've got admitted to the COVID wards have underlying proteinuria, and 10% have increasing creatinine, and about 27% presented with hematuria. The biggest question that puzzled a lot of my colleagues back in New York is whether to continue ACE inhibitors or ARBs, because many of my kidney disease patients are on this kind of treatment. And the biggest concern that we're seeing in the existing literature is hypertension remains an important risk factor, especially the data that emerged out of China suggests that hypertension is a major risk factor. But we don't know as to how many of these patients were on ACE inhibitors. Hypothetically, people seem to suggest that only 10% of elderly Chinese will typically put on A's and ARBs, so the risk versus benefit A's and ARBs is still a gray zone. My former mentor, Scott Solomon, and Dr. Pfeiffer from Brigham and Women's Hospital, while feel that A's and ARBs should not be discontinued in the presence of underlying heart failure, but from the kidney standpoint, if there is no compelling indication for the use of ACE inhibitors and ARBs, you should seriously think of the need to continuing these drugs. And so far, CKD has not been identified as a risk factor as yet, so we're still not sure if there is a protective role for underlying kidney disease or an immunocompromised role for these patients. Some guidelines of how to handle the ESRD patients who are on dialysis who come to your hospital who've got COVID positive, there are strictly two types of patients. If the patient has fever, COVID positive, or COVID avoider, and is actively coughing, there's no question about thinking about the fact that the bedside portable dialysis is the golden rule. They need to have the dialysate efflux into a dedicated drain. All the dialysis machines need to be cleaned with 1:1 bleach, and one-time use of dialyzer and tubing is recommended. You should not be using these dialyzers again. If the patient has been afebrile for more than 72 hours and is COVID positive, and 7 days after the onset, and there's no active cough, then you can continue dialyzing these patients in regular dialysis units. And then it's okay to transport these patients in hallways. It's safe if it's 7 days after the onset of the disease. Again, the conventional cleaning procedures should be 1:1 with bleach and one-time use of all the dialyzers and tubing in these patients. And the most puzzling thing that's come out based on what was presented by Dr. Vijay, the previous speaker, is how the kidney damage is going on in this patient. While there is definitely a component of sepsis and then potential role for rhabdomyolysis in some of these patients, there's definitely a clear role for direct tubular damage, as was pointed out by the previous speaker of the macrophage activation syndrome. The kidney injury seems to present at a median period of 7 to 15 days, And the incidences are strikingly different in different cities, ranging from 0.5 to 23%. The New York is seeing a higher incidence of kidney disease, especially in African-American population and Hispanics, who are highly susceptible. And 25% of those patients who have kidney disease need dialysis. And as this previous speaker pointed out, we're seeing in the biopsies of the patients who were infected with the COVID-19, at least the autopsies showed that there is CD68 macrophage infiltration of the tubular interstitium, and there seems to be a direct tubular damage because the documented nuclear capsid protein in this tubular epithelial cells. The most important thing to note is in the presence of acute kidney injury, the risk of mortality remains, turns out to be strikingly on the higher side compared to if you do not have the kidney disease. The biggest question is RRT initiation. Some of the schools back in the United States have a low threshold to initiating dialysis, while typically in India, considering the financial constraints, we tend to defer dialysis unless there is an urgent indication. There are people in New York, because of the dialysis constraints and the staff constraints, are leaning towards more use of diuretics in the presence of fluid overload, and a balanced use of crystalloids, as Dr. Shiva pointed out. You have to be liberal, but at the same time be extremely cautious so that you don't tip the patient towards the fluid overload situation. As far as possible, try avoiding dialysis unless there is a compelling indication where the respiratory parameters are not improving, where you think potentially the AKI is worsening and that the present uremic situation could jeopardize the life of the patient. Now, how do we handle severe acute kidney injury patients needing CRRT? There's a prescribed dose of 30 ml per kg per hour, but I think the schools in New York are now, the hospitals in New York are leaning towards SLED, basically because of the staff constraints. The CRRT means your dialysis technician is sitting there for long hours getting exposed to the patient, and the SLED seems to be a better option so that you can move on the standard dialysis machines that are used for SLED to other patients. And so far, the studies have not shown that there's no difference between the CVVHD and SLED in these patients. And the early initiation of dialysis has not been shown to improve the overall outcomes. Try to limit your dialysis to 8 hours, again, to make sure your dialysis machines can be used for other patients. You typically tend to need higher doses of anticoagulation because of the procoagulant states, because of the cytokine storms and such. If you're doing CRRT, be extremely careful with the citrate toxicity because of underlying liver injury. Some of the hospitals seem to use high flux filters because of the convective transports, and potentially they can take out the cytokines. Now, one of the concerns that people have expressed is in the dialysis effluent, the COVID virus, could this potentially compromise the hospital safety systems and operations? No. It's been documented that while there's a dedicated effluent needed for these dialysis machines, the risk is very minimal. The other thing that I forgot to talk about is the dialysis risk of passing COVID virus in the urine. The infection risk of COVID being passed in urine is also not pretty high. Some extracorporeal therapies are being used across Spain and the United States in desperate situations, especially there have been use of CytoSorb filters outside of the FDA, which is an offline indication to treat cytokine storm. Of course, that's beyond the discussion of my nephrology field. And often the decision to use CytoSorb filters is that in the hands of intensivists and internists. The most important thing we need to be aware of is you need to safeguard your staff and limit their exposure to the patients. And the long hours of dialysis means our dialysis staff are at high risk of getting exposed. And almost 25 to 30% of dialysis technicians back in the United States are getting infected. So a strict suggestion not to let your staff stay along with the patient and have a camera monitoring of the patient vascular access so that there is no bleeding from the vascular sites. And the monitoring is done from outside the ICU chambers and not directly with the patients. As far as possible, try to have 1:1 shortage, especially in a country like India, it's not going to be practical. There seems to be increasing interest in acute PD program across the United States, which is a reasonable option considering the dialysis constraints if we are overloaded with a lot of patients, one option for us to consider is the CAPD program. The advantage is that these cyclin-assisted CAPD programs don't require the staff to be sitting there and monitoring these patients. Once you connect the cycler at night, you don't have to go until next morning to remove the cyclers. The only problem with the PD is the efficiency is a lot lower than dialysis machines. And the biggest problem is the middle molecular clearance is not good. And then you have to be cautious with some of the CAPD fluids, which are lactate-based. Having said that, we should lean towards using CAPD, acute PD initiation, as much as possible in the event of shortage of dialyzers or the staff. In summary, while there is no clear contraindication or the clear role for AS or ARBs, I would suggest a cautious use of ARBs and see if there's a compelling indication to using them. While it's too early to discuss long-term outcomes of these patients, especially the data that's come out of China cannot be totally trusted upon based on the recent reports from the United States, conservative measures as far as possible, like diuretics, potassium binders, and balanced fluids consumption is reasonable. Try to avoid dialysis because of the constraints on the system and staff. But of course, the intensivist can take a clear decision on the immediate need for dialysis. CRT, SLED, and acute PD depends on the expertise of the staff and center. And the most important is take care of your staff who are at high risk of getting infected, especially in the context of COVID-19. Thank you, Dr. Naveen, for facilitating, and thanks for all the online folks for the
talk.
Thank you,
sir. We'll move on to next topic. That is Dr. Ganesh. He is the head of hematology and hemo-oncology from Yashoda Hospitals. He would talk on hematological manifestations in COVID. Dr. Ganesh, over. So your audio is not there. I think you should. You put on mute. I think you have to unmute. We're not able to hear you. Not able to hear you, sir. It's with him or us? With him. Shall I move on to next topic? That is the last. Move on to the next topic. So we are not able to get your audio through. I'll move on to the next speaker and we will rectify and come back in the next 5 minutes. So Robin will discuss with you to get back after 5 minutes. So now I'll move on to the last topic. That is by Dr. PBN Gopal, who is the Director of Critical Care at Continental Hospitals. I request him to speak on medications for COVID patients and also cover overall management of COVID patients.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Audible?
Yeah. Yes. Good afternoon, everyone, and namaste, keeping in the view of the times. A plethora of speakers have spoken before me, keeping in and putting in all the data and all the facts coming across from various centers of the world of what all the problems are, and typically left it for the internist in the intensivist to sort out the problem. But having said that, is it okay? Right.
Carry on.
Thank you. It's a wonderful initiative by AIG under the leadership of Dr. Reddy and Dr. Naveen to initiate this critical care problems in COVID, which is raging across the world, and India and Hyderabad being no exception. So we need to see what lies in front of us, what is the basket of therapies, drugs especially, that are available to deploy to rescue whatever patients we can. The virus and the information about the virus is virally spreading across the world. Every day we are getting inundated with a lot of studies, anecdotal, in vitro studies, etc. And trying to try that magic bullet, find that particular magic bullet to stop this COVID onslaught on human race and our patients in our individual institutions. But have we found that game changer yet is the question. If you ask me a plain answer, probably the answer is no. It's very disappointing. It's very disappointing that despite this much progress of health science, research, and our various coronavirus attacks that happened in the last 2 decades, still we don't have a clear-cut answer, a broad-spectrum answer to all these medicines. The World Health Organization, the CDC, the FDA are actually clearly saying that there are currently no medications or vaccines. And they are saying that whatever pharmacological therapy that you may have in your armamentarium has to be reserved for very sick people, not for the young fit who may be infected with mild symptoms and with no comorbidities. But having said that, it becomes our duty and responsibility to look into whatever we have and see whatever little evidence, in vitro, in vivo, animal, retrospective, cohorts, to see whether it will help in the short given warning that our patients can be benefited from. So these are the plethora of drugs. We'll try to quickly go in the given time to this and see whether any one of them have an iota of a chance to be treated in our patients and give us some positive result. The topmost of that is no new drug to countries, especially the third world countries like India, which is chloroquine, which is an anti-malarial drug. It has got good in vitro activity against SARS-CoV-2 and may have immunological properties. But having said that, various mechanisms, which I don't need to elucidate to this learned audience, because we have been treating malaria for time immemorial now using this particular drug. And the in vitro data and preclinical data is showing some activity against SARS-CoV-2. But when we come to reported benefit in inhibiting the exacerbation of SARS-CoV-2 pneumonia, it's a bit disappointing, along with the risk it is. It is being used in two realms of the disease. One is preventive, another is therapeutic. Its sister molecule, this is hydroxychloroquine, which has been actively used in prevention of malaria and more actively being used by rheumatologists across the world in our country, seems to be being used more and tried more, especially in China and other countries. The preclinical in vitro data suggests activity against SARS-CoV-2 again. In vitro study says that it may be more active than chloroquine against SARS-CoV-2, especially in prevention. And ICMR has actually initially given recommendation for 400 milligrams twice daily on day one and then a weekly dose for 3 weeks in some subsects and 7 weeks in some subsects to be used as a preventive medicine. But it has not been proved yet. It exhibited high in vitro antiviral activity compared to chloroquine when added to before the viral challenge occurs in these patients. But such patients probably come from a cohort of patients who are already using this drug, probably for malaria or for some rheumatological diseases. There was an open label non-RCT comparative trial of HEQ being used in 26 patients as compared to the control group, and the proportion of patients had negative PCR results significantly differed between these two groups. That was a bit encouraging. On day 6, 70% of HEQ treated patients benefited as compared to only 12.5% in control group. The additional trials in this area are still awaited. Now, the most used drug across the world, especially in India, as the disease is emerging more and more into critical state, is the lopinavir-ritonavir combination, which is not new to our physicians and especially those concentrating on ART treatment for HIV patients. This is a protease inhibitor. It binds to Mpro, a Cre replication enzyme, and suppresses the viral activity in broad range of coronavirus. In vitro and animal studies, potential activity has been shown in previous epidemics such as SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV. The open label RCT trial confirmed SARS-CoV infection to be preventive in 14 days, where a combination of RT and versus standard care was compared. Time to clinical improvement, there is no difference. 28-day mortality, there is no great difference. Similar percentage of patients with detectable RNA were seen in both the groups. No difference in the duration of post-treatment viral shedding in this particular group, but there are risks. The surviving sepsis guidelines did not recommend the use of lopinavir-ritonavir combination in SARS-CoV-2 infected patients, but cautioned that the patients with hepatic disease and hepatitis can happen. And if you see the list of interactions of this drug can undergo with various drugs that are being used in a critically sick patients with coronavirus or COVID or multivarious. There was an NEJM publication which is yet to be published. It is available on NEJM.org, released on March 28, 2020. It's a trial of lopinavir-ritonavir in adults hospitalized with severe COVID. They clearly say in hospitalized adult patients with severe COVID-19, no benefit was observed with this combination with severe illness and may help to confirm and exclude possibility of the treatment benefits. We have to do further trials, and if you see in the plot, there's no particular difference. What about ribavirin? Ribavirin is doing rounds in certain areas. Some people are talking about ribavirin. Not much data is available about this. It's a nucleoside analog. Many patients with SARS-CoV virus were treated with a combination of ribavirin and steroids. In vitro testing did not show any efficacy. There are significant side effects. In fact, ribavirin steroid combination showed increase in viral load where viral load couldn't be tested in some patients. So there is a big caution. Ribavirin is currently not being recommended in this particular syndrome. Then remdesivir, there seems to be a lot of promise in this particular region, but unfortunately this is not available in India. Investigational is an investigational nucleoside adenosine analog, prodrug to a remdesivir triphosphate combination and an inhibitor of RNA polymerase, evades preference proofreading by viral nucleoside, which actually copies and develops resistance. It inhibits SARS-CoV, MERS-CoV, and BAT-CoV replication in human epithelial cells. That's where the promise lies. Broad-spectrum antiviral with in vitro activity against coronavirus demonstrated significant activity against coronavirus in high genetic barrier to resistance in preclinical trials. It exerts potent antiviral activity against a clinical isolates or SARS-CoV in vitro. Administered in various syndromes across US, across European Union and Japan with special permissions. The other molecules that are doing a bit of round are flavipiravir, especially available in Japan. It was noted in press that flavipiravir is hoarded by Japanese government and not released into market. Other drugs are yet to see any clinical use or even retrospective or in vitro use. Then oseltamivir, almost all the patients who are presenting with COVID pneumonia are being put on oseltamivir, but there is no solid evidence for that. But there is certain group of patients who are coming up with co-infection. The co-infection of H1N1 infection plus COVID. I have one such patient where oseltamivir and antiviral combination is showing some result. It's too early to talk about it. But right now, apart from the Paris study, which studied the MERS-CoV outside H1N area, there is no good evidence or even anecdotal data to support oseltamivir. Then comes adjunctive and supportive therapies. The azithromycin is no new drug thought. It's a macrolide. It is being used for several years across the spectrum in the spheres of pulmonology, ENT, community acquired pneumonia. Now that has seen some promise into the area of preventing and treating COVID virus. But a caution is there. Recently, caution has gone up against the combination use of azithromycin and HUKS or chloroquine because of the prolonged QT interval and observation of sudden deaths in certain unexpected individuals. Our cardiology colleague has spoken at length about it. It may prevent the bacterial superinfection though, because once you ventilate such patient, it is but natural that they become susceptible to secondary superinfections within the hospital setting, and that's where azithromycin may come in a bit handy. Virological clearance on day 6 by addition of azithro to HQ has been seen as against only HCQS preventive treatment. MERS-CoV in a sample size of 349 patients, when it was tried in a retrospect analysis, macrolide therapy with antiviral, it was not associated with reduction in 90-day mortality. There are risk of cardiac arrhythmias and there are significant drug interactions. Then we move on to see whether there are any studies about this combination. There was no evidence of rapid antiviral clearance in this French trial or clinical benefit with combination of hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin tried in COVID-19 infections. The FDA approved drug ivermectin for anti-parasite effect has been tried in vitro in Australian Petri dish studies, which shows that it is able to affect a 500-fold reduction in RNA test and suggests that it merits further investigation. Teclizumab, this is quite often used by our rheumatology colleagues, and it has also been used in stem cell and hematopoietic transplants by hematologists. This interleukin 6 IL-6 receptor inhibiting monoclonal antibody, cytokine release syndrome may be a component of the severe COVID, that's where tocilizumab can be used. A competitive binding to soluble membrane bound IL-6 receptor inhibitor signaling is the main feature of this drug. Retrospective review is available. Tocilizumab plus standard COVID drug therapy may have clinical benefit as an editing therapy, but the regulatory bodies do not recommend this. Clinical symptoms, CT opacity changes, lymphocyte percentage and CRP level all improved clinically in this particular group. There is risk of geoperforation and hepatotoxicity, and caution is exercised in patients with thrombocytopenia and neutropenia and their infusion related acute reactions. Now, COVID-19 convalescent plasma, only yesterday ICMR has given permission for the state of Kerala with a particular region to use COVID-19 convalescent serum. The reason for that is one of the restrictions of using convalescent plasma is that the patient who has undergone COVID-19 critically sick infection should have come out of it at least 14 days ago and should have been serologically proved negative. All the rules and regulations for any hemopoietic cell or any blood transfusion apply to this also, and the convalescent patient should have been tested to be positive 3 times either through the blood or through the endotracheal secretions, and if possible the neutralizing antibody titer should be more than 1 in 3020. India has not reached that point yet. Probably Kerala is just there because Kerala was the first one to report this particular COVID-19 syndrome, and ICMR taking that into cognizance has given, and the jury is out and we need to see what happens in the coming future. In US, with special permission, convalescent plasma is being used anecdotally in Ebola virus infection. It has very successfully treated many patients. Corticosteroids, there is absolutely no role for corticosteroids in simple COVID-19 infection or with minimal symptoms. In complicated disease where patient becomes critically sick, there is a role in combating vasoplegic shock or ARDS. That's what exactly the surveying sepsis guidelines also say. So from there, going on to surveying sepsis guidelines, which may form the main platform of treating any critically sick patient across the world, in which both American and European regulatory organizations and critical care organizations participate, it is very disappointing that with the given evidence or given data today, none of the therapies we discussed in the last 5 to 7 minutes are supported by the surveying sepsis guidelines, namely the immunoglobulin, convalescent plasma, lopinavir-ritonavir combination, and or for that matter any antiviral drug, hydroxychloroquine, or even the use of tocilizumab. None of these are supported by the surviving sepsis guidelines, which is kind of not binding but a guiding light for all of us intensivists across the world. Now if you see the second set of recommendations coming from Asia, which is a very interesting group, this group is called the Asian Critical Care Clinical Trial Group, into which India also participates. They have been sitting and examining data from India. Dr. Jiggy Divetia participated in this and published it in the Lancet. I request everyone to go through. It's a very elaborate 16-page document in which certain light has been shown. If you see the first one, Remdesivir, which is of course not available in India, there is very encouraging sign here saying that the investigational therapy is superior activity compared to lopinavir-ritonavir combination is seen in MERS-CoV. If this goes forward and a clinical trial or the retrospective valid data is actually pooled and Remdesivir made available to more countries affected with COVID-19, probably there is a ray of hope there of more survivals and lessening of the criticality of the total thing. The second one is lopinavir-ritonavir combination itself. Here this group feels there is no significant difference in this particular group. Chloroquine, of course, along with hydroxychloroquine, if you look at chloroquine, according to news briefing, chloroquine showed the progression of pneumonia and accelerated SARS-CoV clearance. So they actually indirectly recommend it, though every sentence ends up saying that there is no conclusive RCT performed in this area and there is the need for RCT. Hydroxychloroquine scores slightly higher than chloroquine, both in preventive and therapeutic areas. Then if you go to intravenous immunoglobulin, the SAB-301 found it to be safe and well tolerated, but the results are not out yet. Convalescent plasma might reduce mortality in severe acute respiratory infection due to SARS-CoV. This is where probably where biologicals and other convalescent plasma groups come in, and we need to study more in this area, especially as the disease is emerging and more convalescent donors will be available. Tocilizumab, no peer-reviewed published data yet in this particular area, because the previous model was from hematological malignancies and stem cell transplant. Flavipavir, which is available in Japan, no peer-reviewed published data. Ultimately, taking all this to consideration, I am sure, taking some cue from Indian government and ICMR, each institution is forming its own protocol. Our hospital has also, Continental Hospital has also formed a protocol, which is very dynamic. It is changing almost on every three-day basis. We are meeting once in a 3 days. That's what I expect any responsible hospital to do, put their minds together and ultimately see, though there is no clear peer-reviewed RCT, strong data evidence, it is too early to talk about evidence-based medicine in COVID, especially outside China. The Chinese trials, which are RCTs, hardly two or three trials are out, but we can wait and see. Suddenly Chinese data seems to be more understandable to rest of the population, which was not understanding it before. Taking a cue from that, at this point, as a responsible group of critical care specialists, aided by all the specialists, we can look at retrospective and in vitro data with more respect, with the possibility that it may help our patients and not neglect it completely. But the jury is out. We are kind of out in the field looking at our own experiences. We have about 5 or 6 patients in our hospital. 2 are critically sick on ventilator, 4 or 5 with mild symptoms. Probably if we meet again in a couple of weeks of time, I will be able to tell you what we have done in those patients and what the results are. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you very much, sir. So how are you protecting your team, sir? You are treating a lot of positive patients. Are there any special things which you want to tell us?
Yes, sir. We have reorganized our ICU into various zones. Zone 1 is clean and regular ICU. Zone 2 is pediatric. Zone 3 is COVID suspect ICU. And zone 4 is COVID proved ICU. In COVID suspect ICU, in COVID proved ICU, because the turnaround time for the testing from the governmental authorities is taking almost 48 hours, we are following universal precautions with fully donning and zero atmospheric exposure. We are also minimizing the time exposure of both nurses and doctors to the COVID suspect and COVID proved patients. The maximum allowed is 6 hours for nurses and 2 hours for doctors. So they go in batch after batch into that. And as regards the pharmacotherapy for prevention is concerned, taking cue of the first release by ICMR into this area, we have selected high-risk physicians, respiratory physicians, and intensivists, and asked them to take HCQS. I'm one of them.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
I think we'll move on to Dr. Ganesh, who is waiting to give a presentation on hematological manifestations. This will be the last topic. Dr. Ganesh, please start.
Am I audible now, sir?
Yes, yes, you are audible. Please go on.
Hello?
Yeah, you're very much audible. Please go on.
Am I audible now, sir?
Yeah, you are audible, sir. Please go on.
So, good afternoon. Yes, sir. Yeah, thank you. So, at the outset, yes, sir. At the outset, I will like to thank Dr. Naveen, sir, for giving me this opportunity to share before I start my talk, let me start with confessing that I too had no first-hand experience.
Ganesh is very difficult. He was talking in between. Yes. Yes, sir, go on.
So when I started preparing for the current short talk, I could find that in the literature in PubMed, there are more than 3,000 publications on COVID-19 over the last 3 months, and not to surprise, more than 50% were from China. So, uh, So coming to major hematological changes, not only these hematological changes are characteristic of the COVID-19 infection, some of them have important prognostic value also in these COVID-19 infected patients. The most common changes seen is mild leukopenia, of which significant lymphocytopenia, the lymphocyte count less than 800 per cubic millimeter. It not only favors the diagnosis, also associated with poor outcome in the patients with COVID-19 infection with severe pneumonia. Apart from that, eosinopenia and monocytopenia also favor the diagnosis of COVID-19 among the patients presenting with viral pneumonia, in which differential diagnosis is one of the coronavirus infection. Apart from that, the markers of inflammation like very high CRP, procalcitonin, because of the cytokine release syndrome, also is characteristic of the COVID-19 infection, high LDH, and most important prognostic wise is hypercoagulable state, wherein the not only the raised PT-APTT, but the most important coagulation parameters like very high D-dimer, fibrinogen, and FTPs, coupled with low antithrombin 3, is associated with the poor outcome in these patients with COVID-19 infections. So these are the recent findings from Lancet as well as American Journal of Hematology. You can see the leukocytosis, mostly neutrophilic leukocytosis, coupled with lymphopenia is characteristic, and it has achieved a statistically significant p-value among the patients who were severely infected with COVID-19 versus those who were not severely infected, not requiring ICU shift. Contrary to popular belief, most of the viral prolomes are associated with varying degrees of thrombocytopenia. Barring exceptionally severe COVID-19 infections, thrombocytopenia is not that common. In fact, thrombocytosis, reactive thrombocytosis, is seen in majority of the patients with the COVID-19 infected patients. And this is all depicted in these curves, both from the Lancet as well as the American Journal of Hematology. Now, coming to the hematological parameters, this is a letter to editor published from the Singapore General Hospital Infectious Disease Group, hematological parameters in patients with COVID-19 infection, of which most notable were lymphocytopenia and eosinopenia and monocytopenia. So the most prominent hematological changes, this study showed that on admission, the most important parameters which were associated with severity of the COVID-19 infection were the lymphopenia coupled with raised LDH, apart from the older age, which lead to ICU admissions in the severely infected patients. Patients who were transferred to ICU had a deeper nadir absolute lymphocyte count, nadir absolute monocyte count, nadir hemoglobin, and high peak absolute neutrophil count and peak LDH as compared to patients who were not very sick, not requiring ICU shift amongst the infected patients. Now, again, this is published in Cellular and Molecular Immunology. Elevated exhaustion levels and reduced functional diversity of T cells in peripheral blood may predict severe progression in COVID-19 patients. Now, contrary to various viral infections, the repertoire of T lymphocyte subset in this viral infection, there is exhaustion and there is reversal of CD4:8 ratio, which is very well maintained in COVID-19 patients. In fact, the most notable finding was the CD45 positive naive T cells, which are important against antiviral immunity. They were found to be profoundly depleted in patients with severe COVID-19 infections. Now, apart from this lymphopenia, the another prominent hematological parameters in patients with COVID-19 infection were the coagulation derangements. And again, this is published in Clinical Chemical Lab Medicine recently in 2020 March. The prominent changes in blood coagulation of patients with SARS-CoV-2 infections. And you can see the PT-APTT, contrary to popular belief, were reasonably well preserved, but what was most significant was the antithrombin, which was markedly elevated, depleted in the COVID-19 infected patients. D-dimer coupled with FDPs and fibrinogen, which was high, the conventional coagulation parameters like PTA-PTT were not helpful either in predicting the disease progression or assessing the disease severity. Rather, the non-conventional coagulation parameters like antithrombin, D-dimer, FTP, fibrinogen were helpful in delineating the severity of disease. Now, abnormal coagulation parameters are also associated with poor prognosis in patients presenting with pneumonia with the COVID-19 patients. You can see the DIC score, the normally the thrombocytopenia being an important parameter among the DIC score. So the platelet count of 50 to 1 lakh was given a score of 1, whereas the severe thrombocytopenia with platelet count less than 50,000 was given a score of 2. You can see of all the severely infected COVID-19 patients, only 23% has severe thrombocytopenia, which is contrary to conventional various viral prodromes associated hematological parameters or hematological changes. Most of the viral infections, like the previous SARS, MERS infections, are our conventional, the commonly seen dengue and other viral infections. Thrombocytopenia is a norm, is a rule, whereas in severe COVID infections, severe thrombocytopenia is seen in less than 1/4 of the patients. The other coagulation parameters useful to calculate the DIC score like D-dimer, fibrinogen, and prolongation of PT was helpful. The score, as per this ISTH criteria, the score more than 5 fulfilling the criteria for severe DIC was seen in more than 71% patients of those with severely infected COVID-19 patients. Now, coming to not only that, there are a lot of the papers coming up that detectable the 2019 novel coronaviral RNA positivity in the blood, and that forms the rationale the off late. There are a lot of paper coming up that apart from the nasopharyngeal swabs, even the blood may also form a important means of detecting the novel coronaviral RNA, which is still not routinely performed across the globe. But yes, because of the possible presence of the coronaviral RNA in the blood, and there are a lot of dilemmas coming up with regard to in the transfusion medicine, the possibility of blood safety in those asymptomatic carriers, that is also a huge dilemma. So, even though at this point of time, across the globe, there is no recommendation about the possible testing for novel coronavirus RNA amongst the blood donors. Now, coming to the treatment, the previous speaker has elaborated in detail of all the available emerging treatment options in patients with severe COVID-19 infection. Coming from hematological hematological perspective, the treatment options which I would like to discuss briefly is conventional plasma exchange, low molecular weight heparin, and high dose IVIG. So there are a lot of reports about the role of convalescent plasma in severely infected patients. The vast majority of recovered patients of COVID-19 develop neutralizing antibodies to various SARS coronaviral 2 proteins, mostly 2 to 3 weeks following infections, and this can be documented by ELISA. Logically, transfer of this plasma from such infected and then recovered patients should neutralize virus in those with severe infections or those with parameters suggestive of progression to severe infection, which may prevent further viral replication and halt ongoing tissue damage. This works best with less severe infection and earlier in the disease course. For that, so it's kind of adaptive passive immunotherapy, which is into practice in hemato-oncology and in the field of stem cell transplantation for many decades. This is particularly useful in transplant group as an adaptive immunotherapy for severe CMV and other viral infections. This can be used to protect or treat the severe COVID-19 infected patients. This treatment dates back to more than a century, and this has been used in previous epidemics for various infections like rabies, hepatitis B, polio, measles, influenza, Ebola, SARS, and MERS. They are most effective when used early in the disease course, And this was what used in Wuhan in China extensively, leading to significant recovery and improvement in many of the critically ill COVID-19 infected patients. Now, use of convalescent plasma, this potential risk of plasma infusion remains, like transfusion transmitted other infectious etiologies apart from the various other complications like trali or TACO. So in with regard to recommendations, US FDA is still working with NIH and CDC and has permitted use of this therapy in severely infected patients in New York and other cities. The Moser protocol has been prepared, and there are three ongoing multi-center trials in North America which are still on for this type of passive immunotherapy trials. So apart from that, biotechnology companies are racing up to develop purified antibodies against COVID-19. Now, apart from this novel treatment approach, an argument for the use of therapeutic plasma exchange for fulminant COVID-19, there are a lot of papers coming up. As with any other severe fulminant viral infection, the role of plasma exchange as a potential therapeutic option for those with fulminant COVID-19 infection, there are still a lot of trials going on. So overall, with regard to hematological perspectives, we have more questions than answers. But yes, from the literature, significant lymphopenia coupled with high LDH and deranged coagulation parameters portend to severe disease with possible high mortality rates. Therapeutically, convalescent plasma, plasma exchange, high dose IVIG seems to offer better responses in critically ill COVID-19 patients. My second part is brief about the COVID-19 infected patients in hematology, hematological patients. I'm sorry, the slide set has probably I had lost. But yes, those particularly the hemato-oncology and hematological patients, the mortality has been documented more than 50%, those acquiring the COVID-19 infections. So as all of us are facing, we try to focus on minimizing the hospital care, hospital visit to all our patients to keep not only the patient but us healthcare workers safe from the possible hospital acquired infections. Apart from that, the as Dr. Mithun Sharma sir has elaborated, the transplants, we are trying to strike a balance between our the science teaching versus the current COVID-19 crisis. We are trying to focus on emergency care, and we are trying to undertake only emergency transplants and emergency chemotherapies. So with that, I will conclude my talk. Thank you, Ved.
Thank you, Dr. Ganesh. There is some theory that it is the lung alveolar damage is probably due to hemoglobin dissociation dysfunction, as well as heme-mediated injury to the alveoli. Is there any credence to that theory? And it's not really an ARDS, but it is something akin to a high altitude injury to the lung.
Yes. So that is a very pertinent point, sir. That's the lot of papers are coming out claiming that theorem of that hemoglobin dissociation of leading to hypoxic lung manifestations, and that's the reason why the conventional ARDS ventilatory protocols are not very helpful, and in high oxygen the ventilatory parameters, the ventilatory protocols focusing more on oxygen supplementation helping in patients with severely infected COVID-19 patients with pneumonia.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. So we have come to the end of an elaborate session of 10 topics. We have a lot of questions coming in, but we cannot answer because of short of time. We have already spent 2 hours. So we will come back and answer them, or our speakers' email addresses we will be providing. You can directly talk to them. And thank you all for a patient listening for such an extended session. Thank you.